special welcome to our friends worldwide who are watching via live stream tonight and joining in the conversation via hashtag FoodSovPrize. And those of you in the audience, feel free to tweet along with the rest of the world. My name is Allison Cohen, and I serve as the Senior Director of Programs for Why Hunger. Why Hunger is a proud member of the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance, who organized and is sponsoring the 5th Annual Food Sovereignty Prize. The Food Sovereignty Prize honors innovative grassroots organizations around the world that are fighting for the right to food for all and dignity for those who put food on our plates. This year's event takes place during a time of crisis in the United States. The shutdown of the government, almost 2 weeks old now, brought on by a stalemate in the legislature, has left thousands of families in the U.S. with fewer options to access food. At Why Hunger, through the National Hunger Hotline, we are fielding calls every day from families who are impacted by the shutdown and face new challenges in accessing food. For instance, a furloughed federal worker from Florida who needs help for the first time feeding his family because his paycheck has been suspended. A Tennessee woman who can't apply for food stamps because the federal hotline has been shut down. And a Kansas grandmother who is no longer receiving monthly food boxes through a government program which has ceased to operate. Not to mention the languishing farm bill, which continues to prop up a global food system that undervalues the cost of production and destabilizes rural communities in the U.S. and worldwide. This year's prize has particular resonance, not just because of this unusual turn of events in the halls of Congress, but also as the alternative to the World Food Prize, whose award ceremony is, not so coincidentally, taking place on Thursday this week in Des Moines, Iowa. For more than a quarter of a century, the World Food Prize has promoted increased food production through technology as the way to end hunger. By contrast, the Food Sovereignty Prize champions agroecological solutions coming from communities most impacted by the injustices of the global food system, who, in many cases, risk their lives in order to stay connected to and nourish the land that nourishes them. This year's World Food Prize laureates include scientists from Syngenta and Monsanto, who are being singled out for their contributions to feeding the world through the field of agricultural biotechnology. But we all know that translates into growing profits, not growing food, and definitely not growing community. The story the World Food Prize tells is not the real story of the struggle to end hunger. The real story is being told here tonight. A story of the thousands of communities and organizations around the world who struggle to protect the land, water, and soil from GMOs and multinational companies whose science and business practices threaten not just farmers' livelihoods, but their long-term prospects of feeding their families and their communities. The 2013 Food Sovereignty Prize has chosen to honor four rural community-based organizations from around the globe that are reclaiming control over how their food is grown, what they produce, and how their communities get access to it. Tonight, we are celebrating grassroots activists, farmers, and organizers who are working towards a more democratic food system. This evening, we are celebrating the work of, from Haiti and Brazil, the Group of Four and the Dessalines Brigade. From Europe, the Basque Country Farmers Union. From Mali, the National Coordination of Peasant Organizations. And from India, the Tamil Nadu Women's Collective. We are also joined tonight by former winners of the Food Sovereignty Prize, CIW and MST. We are here to honor these grassroots activists, and perhaps more importantly, to learn from them. As the Food Sovereignty Prize honorees tell us their stories tonight, I encourage you, in fact, I dare you, to not be inspired by their struggles against the massive land holdings of the global 1%, the consolidation of seed companies, the branding of farmers as terrorists just because they organize, and the increasing need for and reliance upon food banks, even in the global south. And I know you will be motivated and encouraged by their examples of building solidarity across nations. Agrarian reform led by women and peasants, youth and farmers organizing as new leaders, and the rejection and destruction of hybrid corn seeds donated as a part of a relief package from Monsanto. Tonight's honorees are at the heart of a strong and growing movement for food sovereignty. I'm humbled to be here tonight in support of them and to welcome all of you to stand in solidarity alongside them. Our master of ceremonies tonight is Blaine Snipstall. Blaine is a farmer, organizer, artist, and seed keeper of Afro-Indigenous ancestry based in Baltimore, Maryland. He serves as part of the regional and youth leadership of La Via Campesina. He is a board and farm member of SAFAM, Southeastern African American Farmers Organic Network, the only African American organic farming network in the southeastern United States. Now please join Blaine and our honorees as they lead us through a mística to begin our ceremonies.
Oh. me in my grave and go home to my Lord. And be
folk and Piedmont blues. Alongside her career as a recording artist and singwriter, she has maintained a steady involvement in causes she believes in, and including supporting her brothers and sisters in Indian country via fundraising, leadership, and education, and now through her involvement with Why Hunger, where she uses her passion to give voice to the voiceless. Martha combines her music and activism during an annual traditional music workshop that she holds within the United Horma Nation's Cultural Enrichment Summer Camp that teaches children about the music from her Choctaw and Cherokee heritage. Please join me now in welcoming Martha Redbone to the stage.
Never can it be.
Thank you, Ms. Martha. That was beautiful. I really appreciate that. When I decided to do this event, I thought I was going to get like a couple of days away from the farm, to relax, sleep in. I woke up at 5:50 this morning, and they've been putting me to work since. My heart's beating, running around here, but I'm very overjoyed to be here. Our keynote speaker is someone who is very special and close to me, although I've only known her for a very short amount of time. To me, she represents an age-old legacy within the Black agrarian tradition of a leader who really stands in the front and takes the brunt of the struggle on behalf of the communities that they represent. So for that, I stand here in great reverence and respect to her. Ms. Shirley Sherrod is an incredibly humble and beautiful and eloquent leader, and she has, I asked her, what am I supposed to say about you? And she said, I'd prefer if you said nothing. And I told her I was instructed not to do that. So I'm gonna go ahead and read a few lines, and I'll leave open space for her to add her beauty to the moment, which I know that she will. Most notably, Ms. Shirley Sherrod was forced to resign from her position in the U.S. State Department of Agriculture, which is a historical moment. She was, to our knowledge, the first and only person from the USDA to be asked to resign based upon discrimination. How ironic, because she was one of the first Black women to be in a leadership position within the USDA, so that the irony is epic in that regard. Ms. Shirley was born in Baker County, Georgia, in November 1947 to Hosey and Grace Miller. In 1965, when she was 17 years old, her father, a deacon at a local Baptist church, was shot to death by a white farmer, reportedly over a dispute about livestock. No charges were returned against the shooter by an all-white grand jury. The tragic murder of her father was a turning point in her life, and it led to her deciding to stay in the South to work for change. In July 2010, after the dispute with the USDA, she decided to re-engage back into her local community and invest the money that she was getting from the settlement into new communities down in central Georgia. So it's with my great pleasure and honor to introduce Ms. Shirley Sherrod.
Fields on our farms and on our farm and doing the other work there, My dream was to live in the North. I thought everyone living in the North was free. I wanted to get away from the South. I wanted to get away from the farm, and I wanted to get away from the Jim Crow laws we had to live under. So I made a commitment on the night of my father's death that I would not leave the South, and I would devote my life to working for change. During the Civil Rights Movement, we didn't have any weapons. Our only weapon was nonviolence. Dr. King once said, nonviolence is a powerful and just weapon which cuts without wounding and ennobles the man who wields it. Nonviolence is a sword that heals. It was the power of the people, farmers. That's why this movement reminds me so much of the civil rights struggle in the South, because it was the people who made the difference. It was the people, ordinary people, not your upper class. Well, I always say to people in the South, we were all in the same boat, whether you were a lawyer, a doctor, or just a farmer. You couldn't eat in any restaurant or stay in hotels. So it put us all in the same boat. And it meant we would fight together. Now things have changed a little today. Things are a little different with the movements we have. We have some people who feel that fight is for others to do. But we know we need everyone.
That's right.
You know, we all have to stand up. Now, there were times when some of us were murdered. There were times when some of us were beaten. But we had to use what we had, which was ourselves, and that's what we need in this movement, in this food sovereignty movement, to make a change in this world. It's so good to have people, not just from one country, not just from two, but people from many different countries who know what it takes to feed the people in our community, who know what it will take to bring back the right for us to do so in our communities, and who are willing to stand together to do that. Here in the United States, I know everyone thinks everything is probably okay here. Everything is the way it should be. But we know that's not true, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Here in the US, farmers have suffered for years, trying to fight the systems that have now been taken out into other countries, and you're dealing with some of the issues that have been taken into your countries that we were dealing with early on that shouldn't be. But here in the US, we have, well, you probably heard all of the news, well, all of us who live here know about the dysfunctional government and the fact that things have been shut down. You wouldn't believe how that plays out in the rural area. This is a critical time for farmers in the rural area because it's harvest time.
Yes.
And it's harvest time at a time to have to be harvesting and have the systems shut down that are important to farmers is just a tragedy for those of us who have to deal with issues of markets and so forth on a daily basis. And I don't want to take anything from urban farming, because I'm so proud of what happens in the urban area these days. As I visit various cities and see people growing food, see people looking to buy food directly from farmers, it's a great thing to have that happen, because we can't do this movement with just a few people being concerned. This movement has to have all of us who understand what fairness is all about, working together to try to make the difference that's necessary. Movements aren't made from the top.
That's right.
They come from the bottom. And that's what's so good about the food sovereignty movement, because those of us at the grassroots level understand, and we work hard to try to help our sisters and brothers who seem to have plenty, understand that, you know, some of that food that you eat is not good for you. we can tell you about it, and you see it play out in diseases and so forth, year after year. But back to the U.S., I just want to tell you that the fact that we do not have a farm bill here in the U.S. is really hurting farmers. The fact that we don't have a farm bill for programs that have been important to farmers, for example, like Section 2501, we fought hard for that to be included in the farm bill, I believe around 1990. Section 2501 provides funds for organizations to help farmers who really need to help with training, with markets. It helps our land-grant universities, our minority land-grant universities really be able to provide the assistance that's needed for farmers. But when you don't pass a farm bill, it takes all of that away. Now let me tell you, we know from experience that movements will start, go quite well for a while, experience a few successes, a few failures, and somehow do not end but seem to lose its effectiveness. In many cases, people are looking for a quick fix to get back to what is perceived to be normal. This work is too important to allow that to happen. Dr. King once said, change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but comes through continuous struggle. Human progress is neither automatic nor inevitable. Every step toward the goal of justice requires sacrifice, suffering, and struggle. It requires the tireless exertion and passionate concern of dedicated individuals. So yes, there will be setbacks, and there will be lies, I can tell you about that. And there will be attacks. There will be attacks on those who dare to lead such a movement, but we can't let that divide us. We have to keep our eyes on the prize. You know, they'll choose someone and make them the leader. And we've seen that happen many times. We didn't choose the individual. They chose the individual. And then you look up and everything that individual says or does, you're reading about it, but that's not who's important to the movement. And talking about attacks, y'all, I was completely taken by surprise just a little over 3 years ago when a blogger deliberately edited a tape of a speech that I made to make it appear that I was a racist working for the federal government and refusing to help a white farmer. I can't tell you how it feels to think that everyone in the United States think you're racist when you know you've devoted your life to working for others. I had to go home feeling the shame that I felt the entire country felt about me. Shame on her, refusing. In fact, and after I arrived at my house after a whole day, it seems, of driving, after midnight, I received a hate call, you know, and that person ended by saying, good for you, you lost your job, didn't you? You know, but God is so good. And when you do the right thing, that's what we have to keep doing. We have to keep doing the right thing. When you do the right thing, you don't have to worry.
That's right.
So my situation turned around because, hey, the next day the white farmer saw what was happening and even called CNN to say, no, she helped me. In fact, I have my farm today because of what she did 24 years ago. From my boss at USDA, the Secretary of Ag, and a call from the President of the United States. And they offered another job. Now, who would take that job? I've been out there too long, and I've been working. offered my same job. I was state director of rural development in Georgia. They did not offer that job to me.
Tell the truth.
They wanted to give me something else, and I'm sure it would have been sticking me into a little office somewhere there in D.C. at the Department of Agriculture, and you would not have heard from me again. But I've been out there too long for that. Much too long. So this movement is important to future generations.
That's right.
Those of us who have worked the land and worked with farmers who work the land understand what is happening with food production. We also know that there are people who go hungry every night and know there is no reason for that. It shouldn't be happening. That's why my hat is off to the groups who are receiving awards tonight. You know, I spent some time with them yesterday, and I am so proud of the work that they are doing. And I feel so connected to them and the struggles in their country. And that's the way each and every one of us should feel. We should feel that wherever it's happening, we need to help right the wrongs that have happened over the last few hundred years. We didn't start out like this. I can remember growing up on the farm, and the neighbors, you know, we shared everything, and we looked out for everyone. Mm-hmm. We need to get back to that kind of caring in this world. And greed, oh my goodness. Greed has gotten us to where we are. And I know we won't be able to do much about them, but we can do, look at the numbers of us in this world who are not those who have benefited from greed. There are more of us than them. And if we keep this movement going right, we can make it, we can make the change. Look at the civil rights movement. I didn't think growing up that we would ever be able to deal with the gator. He was the sheriff in the county where I lived. I didn't ever think the laws would change so that some of the conditions we had to live in would not be there anymore. Now, everything is not perfect. Please don't make you think everything is perfect, because they are not. We're still fighting. In fact, if you look for me on any Monday night in this year, and I'm in a mass meeting in my home county, because the Tea Party has taken over the school system, and they're wreaking havoc on education. So I just want to be encouraging to you to stay the course. Let's work together. We are not America or Haiti or India. We are people. Whether we are located in this little bit of dirt or that little bit of dirt over there, we have issues that we can work on together, that we should be working on together, and we need to be concerned about others and not have people in this country go hungry because of the greedy laws that have been passed. So it's great to be with you tonight. I really, really thank you. Thank you for the work that you're doing, and thank you if you're not, thank you for the support that you're offering.
Token to, we're all facing a system in which, although it will manifest differently, the strategies and the tactics that are being employed by the system of neoliberal capitalism, we're all being affected by this. And And we must organize in our aspirations and in our visions and our hearts to begin to create a world in which we can all thrive in, not just 1%. And so that's where this slogan comes from. And I don't think there has been a process within our movement in the last handful of years, other than our next awardee and honoree, that really exemplifies this very slogan. The group of four, Dessalines Brigade La Via Campesina, in 2007, Haiti's largest peasant organizations, joined forces as the group of G4, or the group of four, a national alliance to promote good farming practices and advocate for peasant farmers. The G4 represented over 250,000 Haitians, invited South American peasant leaders and agroecology experts to Haiti to work cooperatively to save Creole seeds and support peasant agriculture. Together, the G4 and the Dessalines Brigade, as it became known, have collaborated to rebuild Haiti's environment, promote wealth and end poverty. The partnership also provided immediate and ongoing support to the victims of the 2010 earthquake, and the group of four made global headlines when they rejected a donation of hybrid seeds from Monsanto. Yeah. And so just to give you a brief context, the MST is a social movement from Brazil, and I'll explain it, that roughly has a base of 2 million peasants, of landed and landless farmers. And for folks that might not grasp that number, in the US we have 2.3 million farmers. So a social movement has a base of that size. Imagine the political power, imagine the autonomy and tangible sovereignty that they're able to constructively create, and also give inspiration to movements around the world and across their borders in Haiti. So without further ado, I would like to present the G4 and Dessalines Brigade La Via Campesina.
Cooperation agreement between the peasants in Brazil and the peasants in Haiti. És uma ação de solidariedade e do exercício do internacionalismo militante.
It's an action of solidarity and international solidarity.
Haiti é de um país que todos falam de ajudá-lo, porque é um país que tem muitas carências, muitas necessidades, muita insegurança alimentar.
Haiti is a country that everybody talks about helping because Haiti is a country that has a lot of needs. It has a lot of needs for food and food security.
É também um território em que muitas ONGs fazem trabalhos que não colaboram para uma efetiva soberania nacional.
And it is a country, a land, where a lot of non-governmental organizations go there to do a lot of work. But that work does not effectively support the food sovereignty.
E Haiti é um país que hoje está recolonizado em pleno século XXI.
And right in this century, in the 21st century, Haiti is a country that has been recolonized.
Desde 2004, existe uma força de estabilização do país chamada MINUSTAH.
And since 2004, since the year 2004, there is an unstabilizing force in the country called MINUSTAH.
E as tropas militares que lá estão é de países latino-americanos.
And that armies are made up of different armies from different Latin American countries.
E nós, de Los Movimentos Campesinos de Brasil, sabemos que esta não é a forma de cooperação que o governo brasileiro pode desarrojar em Haiti.
And we, as the peasants of Brazil, we know that this is not the way that the Brazilian government should be helping.
Haiti precisa de cooperação em educação para zerar o analfabetismo.
Haiti needs help to end illiteracy.
Haiti precisa de tecnologias agrícolas, precisa de investimentos na agricultura para que os campesinos possam melhorar sua qualidade de vida.
What the peasants of Haiti need is that they need to develop their agricultural technology and the peasants need help in the land so they can bring agriculture to the
world. 60% dos alimentos em Haiti são importados.
60% of all the foods in Haiti are imported.
É um país que vive uma permanente insegurança alimentar.
It's a country that lives on a permanent food insecurity.
E nosso trabalho é de fortalecer a organização dos campesinos.
And our work is to strengthen the local peasant organizations.
La defesa de las sementes como um patrimônio de la humanidad.
Defending seeds as humanity's patrimony.
E a serviço de la sociedade.
And to the service of society.
E temos trabalho com o meio ambiente.
And we have we also work towards for the environment.
Haiti é país que tem apenas 3% de cobertura vegetal.
Haiti is a country that only has 3% of green coverage.
90% da energia que se consome é de origem de carvão vegetal.
And 90% of all the energy they utilize comes from trees, from charcoal.
Em nome de La Via Campesina e de La Brigada de Solidariedade de Haiti, nos sentimos muito grato. Este prêmio é uma emulação para o exercício de la solidariedade militante entre as organizações sociais do mundo.
And we are really happy with this award. This is an encouragement for the movement that seeks international solidarity between the peoples of the world.
Para concluir,
to end,
las multinacionales do agrobusiness,
the multinational agrobusiness corporations,
ultimamente em Haiti,
lately in Haiti,
têm procurado estimular para que haja agrobusiness em Haiti.
Have tried to really come into the Haiti and create the multinational agribusiness industry inside Haiti.
Tem realizado lobbies junto ao governo haitiano.
They have lobbied the Haitian government pretty strongly.
para que o governo regularize as terras de los campesinos, las pequeñas propiedades.
So that the small pieces of land, the small property of the peasants can be legalized and be given documents.
Para que assim empresas transnacionais,
so that these multinational corporations,
possam implantar cultivos de grãos para o agrocombustíveis,
could impose the cultivation of grains for fuel.
Monocultivos de banana,
single crop of bananas.
E isso não há espaço em Haiti para se fazer essas coisas.
And we, there is no space to do that in Haiti.
Porque Haiti é um território de 27.750 metros quadrados.
Because Haiti is has a territory of 27 million.
750
square meters.
E tem mais de 10 milhões de pessoas.
And has more than 10 million people.
Então não há espaço para as grandes propriedades.
And there is no more space for this large utilization of the land.
O que precisa é estimular a agroecologia.
What it needs is to stimulate the ecological agriculture.
Como o conhecimento tradicional dos campesinos.
Through the ancestral knowledge of the peasants.
E estamos com esse compromisso de dialogar, de trabalharmos juntos.
And we have that commitment to start dialogue and to work together.
E lutar contra o agrobusiness para que não entre em Haiti.
So that this multinational agro industry does not come into Haiti.
Internacionalizemos a luta. Internacionalizemos a esperança.
Let's internationalize the struggle, let's internationalize the hope.
Thank you.
Tout partout
friends everywhere
qui nan état américain
who are in the United States
nous disons en pile merci
we give you so many thanks
est-ce que nous vini pour nous capable participer dans beau événement ça
because we could be here tonight to participate in this enormous event
Haïti c'est un pays grand monde un pays souverain dans affaire manger.
Haiti is a grown nation. It is a nation that could be sovereign in terms of food.
Depuis notre création, rivé jusqu'à année 70.
It was sovereign in terms of food from the time of its birth through the 1970s.
C'est application plan néolibéral qui t'a pas crasé rein souveraineté alimentaire dans pays d'Haïti.
It was the implementation of the neoliberal plan in Haiti that has crushed our chances.
Depuis à partir années 80.
Since the 1980s.
Premier gros coup pays à la parlant, c'était l'élimination cochon créole.
The first big hit that Haiti took was the elimination of its Creole pigs.
Pour te permettre, États-Unis remplacer cochon créole ça yo par cochon grimel qui t'a pas coûté pays à cher.
So that the United States could instead import its white pigs that cost the country so much.
Des cochons paysans yo pas capable de possibilité pour lever dans condition États-Unis d'avec pour lever.
The peasant producers who had had their Creole pigs had no opportunity to keep and maintain the white pigs that the US was sending in.
C'est dans même moment ça capable capable gagner élimination la douane sous toute taxe sous toute marchandise qui entrer dans pays à pour traser production agricole.
At the same time, we took a second hit, which was the destruction of taxes of import tariffs to protect the food that we were growing, so that food that was coming in from other countries could invade our land.
Haïti mangeait 80% de tiwi, et tout tiwi ça c'est des tiwi qui sorti dans Miami 3000 tonnes métriques chaque année.
About 80% of Haiti's food consumption is rice, but now the vast majority of that comes in from the United States.
Dégradation environnement Mauvais politique gouvernement néolibéral yo tout partout.
Environmental destruction together with the terrible neoliberal plans of the Haitian government being enacted throughout the country.
Et ça t'a pas aggravé situation en piti.
Has made the situation much worse.
Et principale source d'énergie pays à 75% c'est avec bois charbon.
The primary source of energy in the country, that is 75%, comes from charcoal, from wood.
Nous avons seulement 2% couverti forestier.
Only 2% of our land is forested.
Nous coupons 50 millions de bois chaque année.
We cut 50 million trees each year.
Je dis à gouvernement qui a la tête pays à utiliser terre pour faire zone franche.
Today, the Haitian government is using this same land in order to create free trade zones.
Pour faire gros projets agricoles.
In order to do mega agricultural projects.
Sous prétexte pour capable payer des pays, des externes pays.
On the pretext that they're going to pay the external debt of the country.
Alors que masse peuple haïtien a mouru à grand bout.
Even though the vast majority of Haitians are dying from hunger.
54% de manger n'a manger c'est de manger importé.
54% of the food that we eat is imported today.
C'est dans contexte ça, quatre organisations dans Haïti pour nous capables que peut-être nous dans affaire la manger créer 4G contrées.
It was in this context that the four largest peasant organizations in Haiti.
C'est une plateforme
so that we could work together to combat these problems, formed a coalition called Four Focused Eyes.
C'est une plateforme qui créée 15 septembre 2007.
It was a coalition that was formed September 15th, 2007.
Et objectif plateforme ça, c'est gonfler force nous pour défendre l'agriculture paysan yo parce que c'est seul agriculture paysan yo qui capable de refroidir la planète là.
Our objective was to shore up our strength and amplify our strength so that together we could protect food, locally grown food. And that is, for one thing, the only way that we are going to cool down the planet. This coalition has as its objective to defend food sovereignty,
defend l'environnement,
defend the environment,
et defend produits importés à rentrer dans le pays.
And combat imported foods that are coming into the country today.
Nous décidons pour une bataille pour une réforme agraire intégrale.
And we have committed ourselves to fighting for an integrated agrarian reform.
Quatre organisations, yo, gen trois là-dedans, yo, c'est même via campesina.
Four of these organizations, excuse me, three of the four organizations are members of Via Campesina.
Tête collective paysan haïtien qui gagne entre 17, qui gagne entre 27 à 43 l'année depuis notre bataille pour souveraineté alimentaire.
One is Tête Collée Paysan Haïtien, which means Head Together Small Peasant Producers of Haiti.
Tête Collée Paysan Haïtien, nous gagnons entre 27 à 43 l'année depuis notre bataille pour souveraineté alimentaire.
We have a history, depending on how you count, of 27 to 43 years that we have been struggling for food sovereignty.
Ou gen MPP ki gen entre 17 à 40 années depuis la bataille pour souveraineté alimentaire.
There is MPP, which is the peasant movement of Papay, which has been working between 17 and 40 years to defend land and food.
Ou gen COS ki gen 17 années depuis la bataille pour souveraineté alimentaire.
There is COS, which is the coalition of organizations of the Southwest, which has been struggling for land for 17 years. There is MPNKP, which is the national movement of the Peasant Congress of Papay, which has been defending land for 17 years.
Parmi quatre organisations, yo c'est sauf COS qui pas membre Via Campesina.
Among these four organizations, only COS is not a member of Via Campesina.
4G a pas vle di quatre organizations.
Four eyes does not mean four organizations.
C'est yon espace dans yon proverbe haïtien qui dit les DG PAM contre avec DG POU nous capables parler sans mentir.
It comes from a Haitian proverb that says when my two eyes meet your two eyes, this is a way to prevent lies.
Organisation ça yo décidé pour défendre agroécologie.
These organizations I have committed together to defend agroecology.
Nous décidé pour défendre semences natives natales.
We have committed ourselves to defend native seeds.
Comme bien commun qui au service de l'humanité.
As a common good at the service of humanity.
Nous décidé défendre agriculture pays à mais pour ça nous besoin d'une réforme agro intégrale.
We are committed to defending the food production of the country, but for that we have as a prerequisite integrated land reform.
Jodi a yon nan tem ki nan organizasyon menm via kampesina yo tap lite pou yon souverenite alimante pou tout planet la kom sel mwayen pou rezout problem manje dan le monde.
We share the commitment and the priority of Via Campesina, which is to work for food sovereignty, is the only way to ensure that there is enough food for everyone in the world to eat.
C'est peut-être ça nous-mêmes, organisation qui n'en cadre yo, nous comptons en pile et pendant notre côté gros remerciement à Alliance pour souveraineté alimentaire qui fait choix quatre organisations yo pour être capable d'ayo pour ça.
That is why we, in the group Four Focused Eyes, we are so happy to be here tonight, and we are so happy that these four groups was chosen to receive one of the prizes for food sovereignty.
Prisa représente produit manger qui sain pour tout le monde capable de vivre sur planète.
This prize represents an effort to work for healthy food for everyone, and with enough food for all in the planet.
Lit ça c'est un lit difficile de regarder une organisation comme Alliance pour souveraineté alimentaire qui se tient dans aux États-Unis.
This struggle is so difficult, and when we look at a group like the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance in the United States,
c'est très difficile pour un pays industrialisé tant que États-Unis.
It is so hard for an industrialized country like the U.S.
qui a profité offrir mon manger empoisonné,
which is offering people all over poisoned food.
Lit ça, nous disons c'est un lit difficile.
We say this is a hard struggle.
Lit doit mener dans le niveau local.
It has to be led at local levels.
Et il doit mener dans le niveau national et international.
And it has to be led at national and international levels as well.
Lit ça a demandé une grosse solidarité.
This struggle requires a lot.
En toute organisation qui défend souveraineté alimentaire dans tout le monde.
Between all organizations and communities that are working to defend food sovereignty all over the world.
We got Dessalines ensemble avec nous.
The Dessalines Brigade together with us.
Pour produire semences légumes organiques.
In order to produce organic vegetables.
La pote collé avec nous dans différentes activités 4G à faire en Haïti.
It is standing with us in the different activities that Four Focused Eyes are undertaking in Haiti.
Nous voulons travailler ensemble avec eux pour partager l'expérience nous et puis combattre ensemble la politique gouvernement américain à mener contre la souveraineté alimentaire des États-Unis dans le monde.
We are happy to share with them and others in order to defend food sovereignty and also to fight against the policies.
En Haïti, puis spécialement.
To fight against the policies of the U.S. government that are destroying our chances for food sovereignty all over the world and especially in small countries like Haiti.
Encore un gros merci.
One more time, huge thanks to you.
Alliance pour reconnaissance qu'elle gagne avec travail qu'elle a fait qu'elle offre 4G pour ça.
Alliance and the recognition that you have given us through this prize to the Four Focused Eyes.
Ensemble avec Brigade Dessalines.
Together with the Dessalines Brigade.
N'a dit c'est pas un mauvais choix. Alliance n'a fait elle choisit quatre organisations pour offrir pour ça.
Say that it wasn't a bad choice that the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance made when they decided to give us this prize. This prize is going to act like a serum in our veins. So that these four organizations can work together and really advance much further. To combat the transnational project that is being projected on us. To combat the free trade plans that are being foisted on us. it's a prize that will help us really advance so much further.
Merci.
Thank you. Osnel already presented the four focused eyes.
Étant donné que nous faisons promotion de la femme,
but since we're promoting women, I chose to say a few words anyway.
Moi voulais attirer attention pour me dire que Haïti gagne 85% population à vivre $2 par jour.
I would like to draw your attention to the fact that 87% of the population live on less than $2 a day.
54% population a vivre à moins que $1 par jour.
54% of the population live on less than $1 a day.
Tandis que 3% population gagne 50% richesse pays en bas.
While 3% of the population control 50% of the wealth amongst themselves.
C'est pour montrer objectif que nous gagnons, bataille pour récupérer souveraineté alimentaire, le vital.
Which is a way to say that the struggle that we are leading to reclaim our food sovereignty is vital.
C'est pour ça nous remercier en pile Alliance pour souveraineté alimentaire, le fait qu'elle fait choix ça.
That's why we would like to thank the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance so much for having made the choice to award us. This prize, it can't make us more proud, but it will push us forward to further our objectives.
Pour nous capables de remporter la victoire, pour le monde capable de manger, pour tout paysan capable de manger normalement.
I think that what it will do is to help us. It will act as a fortifier so that we can move forward, so that all people in the world can have food and all peasants can produce that food for the whole planet.
Surtout femmes haïtiennes, c'est une préoccupation pour yo, les yo pas capable de joindre manger. Ou bay petit yo lè a crié nan yo ça konn fè yo triste et ça konn fè yo crié en même temps.
When Haitian women cannot give food to their children who are so hungry that they are crying, this is devastating to the women who themselves end up crying over the pain.
Donc c'est un devoir, c'est une obligation pour nous continuer de travailler et moi prime ça li encourage nous pour nous batailler plus. Merci beaucoup.
It's a responsibility, it's an obligation that we have to keep on fighting, and this prize will help us to fight that much harder. Thank you.
As a founder of the international peasant movement, La Vía Campesina, in 1993, And Vizcaya continues to be at the forefront of innovative and political food sovereignty approaches. Locally, this organization offers its more than 6,000 members educational and economic support. Its youth program has helped young people return to farming, and it is working to build new relationships between the countryside and regional cities. Due in part to the Basque Country's vibrant network of small farms, cooperative businesses, and strong local food systems, all supported by ENI, the region's rural sector has experienced gains relative to others impacted by the financial crisis. So without further ado, our Basque Union compañeros and compañeras.
Such as those from Haiti, Mali, India, Tamil Nadu, etc. So thank you very much. So often words can be absolutely meaningless, and yet around the world, people are using, forging new words and new concepts. Reciprocity, respect for farmers, the Latin American tumacuay or dignified living. These are all so important because people are working together towards a new system in which everybody has a place, everybody has food in the right conditions, and we are moving away, rejecting a system which is irresponsible, antisocial, and unethical. So this prize for us, obviously a boost to our morale. We are a tiny organization, and this recognition is a good for us, thank you. And it also recognizes the fact that we are still around, and we're still struggling. Basque farmers continue to produce, and Basque consumers continue to want good food. And those who've left the path of good food are more and more interested in learning about what would be good food for them. Basque ecologist movements are working with the Farmers Union towards food sovereignty. In issues that sometimes could be very easily emotive to divide us, and yet we're working together. Basque doctors are increasingly willing to publicly denounce problems caused by fast food, rubbish food. And increasingly we are working to make sure that the invisibility of Basque farmers, women farmers, and the problems they have become visible, and work is done to improve their conditions in every possible way, socially, politically, economically, culturally. Yesterday we were talking about the conditions we are working in at the moment. 55% of young people who say under 26 years are unemployed in Spain. They have no future at the moment. They're offered no future. In the south of Spain, this figure goes up to 65%. 1,800,000 families have no one working. All their members are unemployed. Many children, more and more children, only have one good meal a day, which is a school meal, so I should perhaps qualify the word good. situation would have, we couldn't imagine this situation 10, 15 years ago. Simultaneously, the cushion that previously existed for these people, which would be state supports, are being cut. So dole or unemployment money is no longer available for the same amount of time or with the same amount of money. Expenditure in the health system is down, the education system is down, and social inclusion is down. Thus you have all these young people with no future and no help. So, regards food sovereignty, it's very interesting to see that many of them are turning to the countryside for a way to move forwards and to at least have a good meal a day. Okay? And this is enabling us to increase work towards food sovereignty because we try and help these people find a place to work in the land and give them knowledge to how to work in the land, because obviously they don't have either at the moment. All in all, this prize, as I have said, is an absolute boost to our morale and makes us feel that we are not alone. So thank you very, very much.
So before our next performer comes on, I want to leave us with a question in this historical moment, in this liberatory process that we're in, is, you know, who is going to feed the future, and how, and on what terms? Who is going to feed the future? This is a question we all must wrangle with. So our next performer, Miss Jen Chapman. Hope I didn't mess up and butcher the last name. She has a great commitment to music and activism, as they are lifelong and they go hand in hand. Music is urban folk soul, story songs that search for community and shared meaning, powered by the funk and improvisation of the city and which reflect the diversity of experience. She is a mother, activist, educator, and a student of life itself. Jen was born to give voice to the fight against hunger and poverty. As the daughter of Why Hunger's co-founder, Harry Chapman, her activist spirit is deeply steeped in her songs and performances. Jen's life and passions are reflected through her work with Why Hunger, where she serves on the board. Please join me now in welcoming Jen Chapman to the stage.
Going to play a song for the mothers and the grandmothers feeding their babies. Thank you.
Next up is actually an old family friend. He keeps calling me little brother, which is incredible because I'm not from Mali, but I take it as a sign of respect. Is Ibrahim, and he is representing the National Coordination of Peasant Organizations of Mali. Mali is composed of 11 federations of farmers' organizations on a national scale, representing the interests of nearly 2.5 million farmers and peasants. Family farming, primarily by small producers, is the dominant farmer model in Mali. CNOP's mission is to strengthen the structure of farming organizations and build their members' capacity to influence agricultural policy. This organization was the prime contractor for the development of Mali's first agricultural policy, passed by Parliament in September 2006, which made Mali one of the first countries to put the principle of food sovereignty into law. In February 2007, CNOP hosted Nayalini, the first global forum on food sovereignty in Mali, and has led the hard fight against land grabbing and for the rights of small farmers. Ibrahim, who is a great friend of mine, also formerly sat on the International Coordinating Committee, which is the central body within La Via Campesina. So without further ado, and with great pleasure, I would like to introduce Ibrahim, representing the Farmers Union of Mali. Him and I have traveled around the world together, and I feel we are both part of the diaspora. And I grew out some sorghum seeds this year, and this is also a gift to him, because sorghum is native to West Africa, and he has instructed me on how to cultivate and prepare this for my own household. So I wanted to return the seeds back to him.
Ne soyez pas étonnés si j'ai l'air de quelqu'un qui vient de se réveiller d'un sommeil. J'ai un petit problème avec mon horloge biologique qui n'a pas compris qu'il a fait un bond de 5 heures, qu'il est maintenant en Amérique.
Do not be surprised if I look a little bit asleep because my body has not understood yet that I was 5 hours behind or ahead. I can't remember anymore.
Et je voudrais peut-être commencer par vous raconter comment nous, dans la tradition africaine, la souveraineté alimentaire, la question de la souveraineté alimentaire est vécue dans les familles.
I'd like to first tell you a few things about how, in our African tradition, we perceive the sovereign food issue within the family.
Quand un chef de famille n'est plus capable de nourrir sa famille, la nuit, il prend ses bagages et il disparaît.
When the head of the family can no longer feed the family, in the middle of the night, he will pack his things and leave.
Je parle d'un chef de famille digne, bien sûr. Quand un chef de famille est digne.
And that would apply only to the dignified type.
Je me demande toujours pourquoi on ne devrait pas appliquer la même sentence au gouvernement qui ne peut pas nourrir leur pays.
And I wonder, and again, why we shouldn't apply this rule to the governments that cannot feed their country.
Je pense que l'Alliance devrait réfléchir aussi à distribuer un prix au gouvernement qui doit démissionner pour n'avoir pas pu nourrir leur population.
I think maybe the alliance could come up with a price to the government that could not feed their populations.
Et pour dire que je viens d'un pays, le Mali, qui a été beaucoup cité ces derniers mois dans l'actualité internationale, parce que les deux tiers de notre pays ont été occupés par des gens extrêmement violents qui parlent au nom de l'islam, mais qui pour nous n'ont rien de musulman.
I would like to say a few words about the fact that Mali was covered in the media recently and was in the headlines because for a while, two-thirds of the country was occupied by people who were extremely violent, who talked supposedly on behalf of Islam, but for us had nothing to do with Muslims.
Mais je voudrais pas m'en prendre à ces gens parce que chez nous, il y a un proverbe qui dit au lieu d'en vouloir à là où tu es tombé, il faut en vouloir à là où tu as trébuché.
I won't go on too much about them because we have a proverb in my country that says instead of resenting the fact that you fell, you need to resent the fact that you slipped in the first place.
Et donc, c'est pour vous dire que dans nos pays, au Mali et en Afrique de l'Ouest et en Afrique en général, depuis 1960, que nous sommes devenus indépendants, s'est installé un système de mauvaise gouvernance qui a détruit les moyens d'existence de la majeure partie de la population, qui sont des paysans.
This is why in my country, in West Africa, and in Africa in general, and since the 1960s independent movement, the system that has come into place has gradually destroyed the livelihood of the population because of its lack of governance.
Dans mon pays, en Afrique de l'Ouest, 65% de la population est paysanne. C'est-à-dire que ce sont des gens qui ne demandent pas du travail à leur gouvernement. Ils créent leur propre travail. Ils se nourrissent eux-mêmes et ils nourrissent les pays.
In Africa, in West Africa in particular, 65% of the population is made up of farmers. The farmers do not ask for work from the government. They create their own jobs, they create their own food, and they feed the cities.
Et pourtant, depuis les années 80, où nos gouvernements ont fait appel à la Banque mondiale et au Fonds monétaire international, a été mis en place des politiques de destruction systématique de cette forme d'existence paysanne.
And since the 80s, yet since the 80s, the government requested the help of the IMF and the World Bank, and they came up with a political system that would systematically, a system that would systematically destroy the livelihood of our population.
Quand j'entends parler de mes amis de Haïti ou notre sœur du Pays Basque, l'Europe commence à connaître ce que nous on a connu depuis les années 80.
When I hear our friends from Haiti and our sister from the Basque country, I can see that the European countries are going through what we experienced since the 1980s.
Ces politiques ne nous parlent que d'une chose. Équilibre macroéconomique, croissance, mais ils ne créent rien de bon et ils détruisent tout ce qui existe.
These policies talk about one thing and one thing only, macro-political stability and growth, but all I can see is that it doesn't create anything and it destroys all.
Ce sont ces mêmes chiffres économiques qui nous disent dans notre région que cette agriculture paysanne produit presque 50% de la richesse. Mais en contrepartie, il n'y a pas un seul gouvernement en Afrique qui consacre 10% de son budget à l'agriculture.
So it is that economic data that shows that 50% of the wealth in our countries comes from agriculture, and yet not one government in Africa invests over 10% in its agricultural sector.
Si vous imaginez ce que Farm Bill met en Amérique et ce que l'Union européenne met 40% de son budget pour les 3% de la population qui sont les paysans, vous pouvez comprendre ce que c'est.
So for those of you who have talked about the Farm Bill and those who know how the European policies are organized around 40% goes to the 3% of the wealthiest, I think you will know exactly what I mean.
C'est donc ces politiques d'oppression qui ont été mises sur notre dos qui nous ont poussé à nous organiser pour nous battre, pour revendiquer nos droits.
This is the kind of policy of oppression that pushed us all to get organized and to fight for our rights.
Mais nous avons été d'abord dans un système d'organisation clandestin jusqu'en 91 où nous avons eu un peu de liberté avec l'avènement du multipartisme et de ce qu'on appelle la démocratie.
So we remained informal, really until 1991, when we were granted a bit more freedom through the democratic movement of a multi-partite system.
Et donc, cela nous a permis de pouvoir sortir au grand jour pour dire ce que nous pensons aux mauvaises politiques que notre gouvernement mettait en place, qui non seulement poussait les jeunes à quitter le milieu rural pour aller en ville, où il n'y a pas d'emploi pour eux, mais aussi détruisait les marchés locaux qui étaient livrés aux produits vendus à prix de dumping qui viennent d'un peu partout du monde.
And this is when we became more official and more visible with movements against the government openly. The government who incited the young to leave the countryside and move to the cities and destroyed our markets because of dumping policies that they're applying.
Nous nous sommes battus et nous avons obtenu des choses. Cela, comme mon ami Blaine vient de le dire, nous avons pu amener notre gouvernement à voter une politique qui reconnaît la souveraineté alimentaire, que notre pays doit réaliser sa souveraineté alimentaire. Cela a été voté par le Parlement, mais comme vous le savez, ce n'est pas toujours simple, aussi simple.
And as my friend said, we fought and we won some battles. One of them being that food sovereignty became recognized by the parliament. And yet, as you've also heard, things are far from simple.
Ce n'est pas simple. Je pense que je ne vous apprends rien ici en Amérique. Vous savez comment certainement sont financés ceux qui arrivent au pouvoir. Et ce n'est pas les paysans qui les financent, malheureusement.
And I won't tell you anything new. You know quite well how those in power come to power and who funds them. And unfortunately, the agricultural sector is not, the farmers are not funding them.
Et donc nous avons eu beaucoup de difficultés à appliquer cette politique de souveraineté alimentaire.
So we had great difficulties applying this sovereign food policy.
Mais notre détermination ne fait qu'augmenter avec cela.
Yet this only increases our determination.
Car chaque jour, nous voyons émerger de nouveaux phénomènes, encore plus de marginalisation des paysans, là où ils vivent.
Every day, we see new trends appear. Farmers are more and more marginalized.
Les dernières aberrations politiques, ce sont justement ces phénomènes d'agrocarburant, ou ce qu'ils appellent biocarburant, et qui ont émergé après la crise alimentaire et la crise énergétique. Et récemment, avec la crise alimentaire de 2008, nous avons vu émerger le phénomène de l'accaparement des terres. Donc notre gouvernement a voulu ouvrir le pays à toutes sortes de personnes qui ont de l'argent et qui veulent investir dans l'agriculture.
So we were faced with all kinds of incoherent policies, among them the biofuel fuel that was started after the fuel crisis and energy prices in 2008. And we are faced with land grabbing currently. And our government has opened the lands to anyone who comes with money and investments.
Et donc, nous nous battons pour que nos communautés puissent préserver leurs droits. Parce que ces terres, pour eux, ce n'est pas parce qu'ils n'ont pas de titres de propriété délivrés par un gouvernement. Ils ont toujours vécu sur ces terres. Ces terres sont les terres de leurs ancêtres. Et donc, ils ont le droit de continuer à vivre sur ces terres. Donc, ils ne comprennent pas qu'on puisse venir prendre ces terres et les donner à ceux qui ont déjà de l'argent.
So we are fighting for the rights of our communities, the communities that have lived and worked on those lands for generations, that have, maybe they don't have land titles, but they've been there always. And they don't understand why now the government wants to give the land to people who already have money.
Nous sommes dans un système qui veut tout prendre et qui ne laisse absolument rien. On veut nous prendre les semences, on nous fait voter des politiques favorables aux OGM, aux hybrides, on veut nous prendre la terre. Je pense que ce qui reste, je pense que peut-être qu'ils l'ont déjà envisagé, c'est d'envoyer les paysans dans les chambres à gaz.
We're in a system where the government takes all, leaves nothing behind. We're asked to give the seeds. We're given GMOs and the hybrids, and the land is taken from us. So the only thing that's left, and I'm not sure whether they've thought about it already or not, it's to take the farmers to the gas chambers.
Et donc, je pense que il faut qu'on soit déterminé, qu'on se mobilise, parce que ce qui est important, c'est l'être humain. Ce n'est pas le sac rempli de dollars ou le compte en banque à milliards de dollars qui est important. C'est la vie, c'est l'être humain. Et c'est important de se battre pour ça.
So, what's important to fight for is the human being that is at the center of everything we do. Not the amount of money that is sitting on different accounts, a billion of dollars around the world. But what we're determined to do is to fight for the life.
Mais le système, il ne comprend pas cela. Et donc, nous devons recréer, je pense, un système démocratique où les politiques sont obligés de nous rendre compte. Parce que ce système dans lequel nous sommes tous, aussi bien vous, les pays développés, que nous, les pays encore qui cherchent leur chemin, c'est que ceux qui nous gouvernent doivent avoir obligation de rendre compte à la majorité de la population. Cela n'est pas le cas, je pense.
So, the system doesn't understand what we stand for. Therefore, we need to recreate a system that would be democratic and that would allow for accountability. A system where our countries, developing countries, as well as your country, which is a developed country, we'll have a government that would be accountable to the majority of people, which is not the case currently.
C'est la raison pour laquelle nous devons globaliser les luttes et globaliser l'espoir.
This is why we need to globalize the fight and we need to globalize our hope.
Thank you.
Question back. Who is going to feed the future? How and on what terms? Who is going to feed the future? Our next honoree, I stand here with complete excitement and really just immense amount of love for what they have done in the state of Tamil Nadu in southern India. In the southern Indian state of Tamil Nadu, as in much of India, women have little social, economic, or political power and often struggle to feed their families. Lower caste, Dalit women, indigenous, and widowed women face even greater hardships. Through the Tamil Nadu Women's Collective, 100,000 marginalized women are organized, many in unofficial workers' unions or small collective farms, to strengthen their food sovereignty and thus their broader power. In addition to organizing locally and nationally on issues from their own families food security to land rights to opposition to genetically modified seeds. The collective encourages cultivation of native millet varieties. The hardy traditional grain is nutritious, drought resistant, and easier to grow in the region than wheat or rice. So without further ado, and tremendous respect, I present the Talanadu Women's Collective.
Good evening, everyone. I bring my greetings and best wishes from all the Women's Collective members and the farmers there. First of all, let me start by showing our gratitude and thanks to all those who are responsible for selecting us, and particularly to the Alliance, which made it possible for us to really use this opportunity to share what little that we have done and also to learn from others across the globe. Thank you very much. While I was sitting there, I was just contemplating what should I be sharing with you. Because yesterday we had a dialogue where I was sharing about some of the experience that Women's Collective had. So I was rethinking what should I be sharing with you. I thought I'll just give a little background and why Women's Collective is doing this. Women's Collective has got about 20 years of history. We started in 1994. At that time, our only intention was to strengthen the women's leadership and to empower women. It's all-round empowerment, political, social, economical, cultural, all-round empowerment of women, and political empowerment to begin with. So we thought that the political empowerment at the village level will help us to have access and control over natural resources, particularly the land, water, forest, and sea. So this is the intention with which we started working. And India, as you know, it's a very big country, and it has got three different kinds of area, particularly the Himalayas in the north and the Gangetic Plain in the center. And in the south, it is the Deccan Plateau. The Deccan Plateau people, the main food of Deccan Plateau people was millet. But after independence, when India had to really feed for nearly 30 crores of population at that time, where there was a very big food crisis, then when India decided about Green Revolution, which brought in all the hybrid seeds, chemical fertilizers, and pesticides, the Deccan Plateau also had to lose its millets and change over our food habit, and we started eating rice. So it was morning, afternoon, evening rice. So it was rice, and all these 60 years of this rice eating has taken a heavy toll on the health of the population. So today they say out of the diabetics patients, 50% of them are in India, and out of the cancer patients in the whole world, 30% are from India. So this analysis actually took us very close to what we are doing today, not only from the health aspect, from the nutrition aspect also. It is said that 46% of our children are malnourished. So the eating habit, the change in the eating habit has really infiltrated into the nutrition also, nutrition of the children. So our focus became millet. And it was seen from three different angles. On one side, we facilitated the consumers to consume millet. On the second side, we facilitated the farmers to produce millet. On the third side, we lobbied with the government to include millet in their programs, in their food programs. So I'm sure that you would have heard about the food security bill which is recently passed. So many organizations were involved, particularly the Right to Food campaign was the main leader, and many movements were part of it. And today finally the food security bill is passed, and millet is also included in food security bill. That is one, maybe we can say that it is a success. By the time we sit back and relax and say that it is a success, there is something else coming from the other side. So I'll explain that also. So that is one feather in the cap. The other side, what is happening is, in the last 20 years, particularly after the new economic policy and the structural adjustment program, the quantitative restriction of importing, restriction on food crops, of importing food from outside, is removed from more than 1,028 food crops. So which means it really affected the farmers. So the last 20 years, what has happened is, many of the small and marginal farmers were really pushed out of farming. And the globalized government policy has encouraged a special economic zone and a special industrial zone, which has taken over a lot of agricultural lands. And so that again, the small and marginal farmers have to give up their land. The other factor which took the land is the whole real estate boom that happened in India. There is a link to the whole politics of it. And that also took away quite an amount of land from the small and marginal farmers. So on one side, we lost the land. On the other side, there we got our food security bill passed. Then this is how, this is the situation in which we started working with the women as farmers. In India, women are never recognized as farmers. So our demand was, recognize women as farmers. Although women do 80% of the agriculture work, they are not recognized as farmers. So the first demand was, recognize us as farmers. Second demand was, give us the land. Give us the land to farm, and we are here to produce food, and that produces that food is also traditional food, which is nutritious and which is really going to be helpful to solve all the problems that the current community, the society is having. So this is our focus, and with this that we were demanding, and slowly the women got organized. Particularly when we were trying to organize women, we realized that the women hardly had any land in their name. And even if women had land, they didn't have the decision making, whether what crop to cultivate. And it's always the decision of the men, and men always went for cash crops, which brought them money. So going back to traditional crops and that to food crops, it was difficult to get the women to make the decision to cultivate in their land. So we organized single women, widows, who don't have to depend on their male counterparts to make decision. And we leased out land, and we facilitated these women to cultivate food crops, traditional crops. The analysis that we had was, the whole issue of climate change was catching up. People were talking so much about the food crisis, global food crisis, and the water crisis which is there around the corner. And we were faced with the nutrition crisis and the health crisis and the environmental crisis. So we took it up on us and focused millet as a single solution for all these problems that we are having. Be it the food crisis, the climate crisis, the water crisis, the nutrition crisis, the environment crisis, the fodder crisis for the animals. And the non-fertility, because the land has lost its fertility because of continuous use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides, and we saw millet as an answer for that. And that is how the millet was focused. And today, we have hundreds of thousands of women who are cultivating millet traditionally using just cow dung and urine, not using the chemical fertilizers and pesticides, and also going in for ecological farming, ensuring biodiversity. In a single acre of land, people cultivate anything between 25 to 30 different crops, food crops, which ensures food security at their family level initially. And we want, I mean, this is just a small beginning. There is a long, long, long way to go. As I told you earlier, the food security bill which has come up now, on one side the government ensures that there will be all the people in India would be fed, not particularly people who are below the poverty line. On the another side, the government also says that too many people are involved in agriculture. So you have to only one-fourth of the people who are in agriculture have to remain in agriculture, the rest have to get out of agriculture. So what are we going to do? So that is what the government says, and that is what Manmohan Singh has said very clearly. And then they are saying we don't have enough food, so we have to produce food. In order to produce food, we have to go in for a second green revolution. And what is the second green revolution? That is the GM crop. So the government indirectly is trying to bring in the GM crop into India with this food security bill. Although the fight was from below, the people have fought for it, for their right to food. On one side it appeared as a victory, on the other side the government is trying to bring in the GM crops into India. There is a strong fight against it, like all other companies like Monsanto, Syngenta, DuPont. All the companies are there in India doing their research. But Monsanto very systematically has brought in almost all the seed companies in India. And all these seed companies are working in their own name, but it reflects Monsanto's policies and it does Monsanto's work. So I don't know whether you have heard about this. In 2010, Monsanto and the Mahiko company in India together, they did a research on brinjal. Brinjal is native of India, and they brought out BT brinjal. And our committee, that is the GEAC committee, the Genetic Engineering Approval Committee, approved it, and it went to Parliament, and the Parliament commercially okayed it, that they agreed for commercial cultivation of BT brinjal. Then there was a big fight with the farmers. The farmers really, all over India, they really came to street and fought against it, and we also filed cases in the court. And the Environment Ministry came down to have public hearing in different places, 8 cities in India. And in all the public hearing, the farmers came in large numbers to protest against this. But Monsanto also brought in their farmers to support this. However, finally, the Environment Minister decided to have a temporary moratorium on BT brinjal. So the BT brinjal is temporarily stopped. In the same way, out of the 28 states, more than 10 states have taken a policy decision, including the state from which I come, the Tamil Nadu, has taken a policy decision that they will not allow GM crop in their state. So they have decided that they will be GM free. But agriculture is both in central list and in state list. So if the central government passes an act, and then the state government has to follow it. So that is, there is a but to it. So there are so many bills which are pending there in the parliament. There is a seed bill which is going to give all power to companies like Monsanto and Syngenta, and there is a BRI bill, the Biotechnology Regulatory Authority bill, which is again going to be supportive of these multinational companies. And all our parliamentarians are very in, well, they are in close contact with Monsanto and other companies. So this is a very big issue which is there right in front of us. And I don't see that it is an issue only with India. I see that it is an issue all over the world. Many countries are facing it. And like countries like Indonesia has been really successful in setting Monsanto out of their country. So we also hope that we would be able to do that in India, that we would be able to send not only Monsanto, we want to pack up Monsanto, Syngenta, Cargill, DuPont, we want to pack up all multinational seed companies, and we want to save our traditional, go back to our traditional cultivation and go back to our traditional food. So that there was a question here, who is going to feed the world? The only answer is that is the women who is going to feed the world, and particularly the and this can only happen when our struggle is globalized and we are all together in this struggle. Thank you.
History is any indication of the trajectory that we're on, then I think what we've seen here is that we must take a look at the peasantry as the peasant, as part of the vanguard in the struggle against the imposition of capital, and the vanguard in the construction of new ways of being, of new forms of agricultural food production and political orientation. You know, food sovereignty is the protagonist in the fight against these forms of capital, and it is the creative will upon millions of people across the planet that are vying for the transformation of reality and the transformation of humanity as we know it. So tonight, you know, it's been my honor to be your master of ceremony, and I would like to close out by giving thanks to a long list of people and communities that have given access to us having this event. So first and foremost, I would like to give thanks to the translators. Within La Via Campesina, there's this saying that without translators, there's no revolution. It just can't happen. Next, I would like to give thanks and gratitude to the 2013 Food Sovereignty Prize honorees, awardees, and everyone in their communities that they have represented. It has been an absolute pleasure. I would like to give thanks to our former Food Sovereignty Prize honorees who are with us today, who are part of the Mystica, the CIW, and the MST. And from the Deep South, I would like to give thanks to Miss Mama Shirley Sherrod. And Jen Chapman. Our New York City Local Host Committee. Our sponsors, American Jewish World Services, Food and Agriculture Organization, Lawson Valentine Foundation, the Presbyterian Hunger Program, Small Planet Fund, the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance, and Why Hunger. This event was being live streamed around the world, and so we were told that there was roughly a couple hundred, if not a thousand people around the world watching this live stream event. So I'd like to give thanks. And then give thanks to Fresh & Co., Zishan Hamid, Kidim O, and Mama O's Kimchi. Please excuse me if I'm butchering somebody's name here. The Cleaver Co., Fred Shaw, Al Handel, and Continent Critical, and the photographer Tony Sadler. And we give thanks to Christine Sarkisian and the staff at Cooper Union, who, because of the government shutdown, we had to switch locations, and so they're very flexible and kind to us for giving us this location, so give thanks to them. And to make the folks that are often invisible in these events very visible, I would like to give thanks to a group of folks who have really done some magical work in some very harsh conditions. And so Saulo, India, Kristen, Clary, Lisa, Lily, Luna, the organizing committee, and also with support from Kathy, Brooke, and Allison. You all have been absolutely incredible. And so lastly, I would like to bring back Miss Martha Redbone and Jen Chapman to close out the ceremony and leave us all with some absolutely delightful words. Thank you.
This is Mr. Jamie Foxx playing guitar.
Questions authority, and this evening I think is absolutely apropos that we question who are the powers that be with all this madness going on and what can we do to fix it. So it's called I Rose Up. I'm going to take you to church. All right? Yeah.
system, the Farmers March. I think a lot of you were there. It was in December of 2011, and it was very inspiring. And Shirley Girard spoke about the weapon of nonviolence, and quoting Dr. King, but she also said, so the one thing I disagree with, she said, we didn't have weapons in the civil rights movement, but of course, well, she knows, there was a weapon of song, and it's a powerful, powerful weapon. And we were reminded of this recently, reading how in Wisconsin, which has been on the front lines of the battle for working people, over 200 people were arrested on the steps of the state capitol for singing labor songs. And the governor of Wisconsin, he's got some problems, but arresting people for singing. So let's sing. This is a song. Yes, the Occupy Wall Street was evicted. Some of us were very sad. Martha and I went down there one night, had a lot of wonderful conversations. And that's what it really was. It was about the conversations and asking these questions of all the complex systems and how they work together. And some people say that movement failed, but the conversation continues and people are learning and connecting the dots. And we're gonna connect the dots some more. But sin, that's right, sin. So yes, some people feel like we failed, but as we know, this is gonna take a long time. And that's the refrain of the song, and I want you to all sing it. You'll hear it very clearly, the melody, it's repetitive. And it says, it's gonna take a long time, but we're not going away. So when that moment comes, I want you to all join in. You'll know. Sign called out to the world, the beginning is near.
workshop that has been making signs. And she has asked you all to take some pictures as you head out with her, with these signs as a footnote.